Hello. Hi, good morning, everyone. I hope my
Hello.
voice is. Hey, hi Naveen. Naveen, did you get that link of that classroom? You're asking for that. Are you able to get it?
Not yet, Amit.
Actually, no, there will be sir, the I think that is created by Pawan. So he will have to give you the access to it. So if you can just drop him a message, I think he'll do that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. So I think, so maybe you can access it from that WhatsApp group link as well. I think it's there. In the description, you might find it. Okay.
Okay.
So what I do is I just show you how to move the data from an Excel file, right? So like we were discussing yesterday. So what we do is basically when you click on new, you have some database with you and you have some Excel files and you want to load that data. So what we do is basically, so suppose I have this database with me that is DB customer info. Maybe I'll create a new data. Yeah, maybe I'll use Intuit's this database. So in this database, you know, if you want to load the data from an Excel file, so what we do is one is you simply right-click on that database, right? So what happens is if you right-click on that database now, you click on tasks and import data. So suppose maybe what I will do is these are CSV files. So what you do is you first select the source, right? So the data is in flat file. Flat file as in when you have a data in CSV, so we call that as a flat file in SQL, right? So you choose that flat file and you browse it. You select your file, whichever file you want to load, right? So you will be able to see the columns, whatever columns you have. So you can have a quick look at it. And then what you do is you click on next over here and you select the destination. Destination is SQL Server Native Client 11.0, right? And then what you do is you click on next. And the table that you want to load, so this is going to create the file with the this table that you have. The table, this is going to get a new table for you, suppose, and that the table name will be the same that you have as the file name. If you want to rename that table name, you can do it from here, right? You want to call it as customer or customer details, you can do that renaming from here. and then you click on next, and again next, and finish. So you see now the data is actually loaded from that CSV file over here. So if you just come in this database and open the tables. This let's start from right. So we can see the data is loaded in this table now. So if you have CSV or you have Excel, you just have to select that type from there. So when you're loading it from the data, so when you say tasks, import data, if you have to load the data from an Excel file, so over here, we choose the source as Excel. So that's the only difference that comes up. You choose the source as Excel. So in that case, now you will be choosing an Excel file, and in one Excel, you can have multiple sheets. So you get an option to, or you get an option to, select whichever sheet you want to load the data from, right?
No, if the column order changes, right, you showed us on that day using the edit mappings, you can map the column names from the sheet as well as with respect to the table fields. Oh. After that, I click next, but I'm getting an error. It is not executing successfully. Can you show that?
So if I say this is the data, delete. Let me delete all the data from here. Delete from so now right away is again if I come on the database, right click tasks, and I say I want to import data. And let's say I want to import the data from our flat file. Next. And we come over here, native client, simple server. So you have this table over here, edit mappings. So right now it is going column to column over here, right? So we can see this column, each column going in this destination in this. Okay. So now if you click on OK, so this over here. Next. So the table that we had already, so the data goes in that table over here. The existing table, select the customer table over here. So we have reloaded the data into this. So what was the question in this part? So you were saying that the column structure is different, right? That is what the task is.
Yeah, if the column changes, order changes, I can able to map the from the sheet this particular column name and from this particular table. When I try to click finish, no, I'm just getting an error. Your operation stopped.
So did you read some error? It could be some data type error that might would have happened if there is any data type mismatch. So it shows you the error over there. That what was the reason of that, this topic. So you see messages over there. In that it shows you sometimes data type mismatch happens. Due to that also it doesn't load the data.
Yeah, validation warning, it shows like this particular column with a length of 50 to a database column with a length of 30. Maybe I should correct this length.
You have to correct, increase the length of that. Suppose you have made it paragraph 30 and you're trying to load the data paragraph of 50 size.
Okay.
So that way it gives an error. So it is not able to store that much data.
Okay. But the step... are same, right? Edit mappings, we need to map the columns and yes, just yes. Next finish. Okay maybe I can I can try this. Thank you so much, Amit.
Can I I am getting error while mapping the columns. Can I share my screen quickly? It's ready.
Oh yes, please.
Are you able to see? It's not showing the, if I, I mean, it's not giving me the other column names. If I click anywhere here, I want to map the CNAME to customer name, but it's not showing like all the names. It's showing only one column and saying ignore.
Once again, so this customer ID, customer name, so this is the sequence that you have kept in the table,
before,
right?
Yeah, source file is from Excel and the destination is the table in my order I created in the SQL.
So, one second. So, source is customers, destination is customer one. And you are doing this over here.
Customer email ID is mapped to wrong. Yeah,
it's not. If MID membership.
Click on ignore. Just click on ignore once.
Sorry.
Click on ignore. I think it will. I get it because I think in SQL Server what happens it creates an issue with that. You have to do this stuff with the help of SSIS. Okay. Got it. Because this is. Where what will now happen is you will not be able to map this up.
Okay, so I have to click ignore to everything, then I have to map again.
Right, so then you do it.
Okay.
So basically in MySQL what happens is it gives you all the names only. So this is where in MySQL also they do it this way. They make it, you have to ignore it and then you reassign that column name to it, which one do you want to assign to it.
I'm not getting what was the point. If she clicks ignore, how come the system will understand this particular column will be mapped to my SQL table?
So basically what happens is the thing is that you have all the column names over here. So she has the file, CSV file. In that CSV file, you have column CID, MID, CNAME and CEmail ID. Right? That is the sequence of the columns that you have. Okay. I'll just tell you, you can just load this. So you can just validate it once.
Just
show the screen once. So what happened is this is the sequence of the column. So let me just share my screen. So let me share it.
Yeah.
You will have to share the screen again. You will just have to do it again. Just I want to explain what is the thing that we are talking.
So can I stop share?
You can stop sharing. The issue is this, for example, we are talking of what happens is basically in CSV file, the CSV file from where we are loading the data, right? You have column A, column B, column C, column D, and column E, right? And that table, the SQL table where we are loading the data, in that table that you have already created. Over there, you created the tables like this. First, you had B, then you had C, then you had A, then you had E, then you had D. Right? So, these are the column names in SQL and these are the columns which are actually in CSV. So, by default, A goes into B, B is going to C, C is going to A, D is going to E. So we are trying to map the correct column to correct column. So that is where what we are doing is, so in that edit mapping, you come over here, it is showing you B. So you first make it ignore, you ignore this. And that way what will happen is, ignore means because right by default what has happened is, SQL has done the mapping that A will go into B as a default. So we say ignore this mapping. So when you say ignore, now after ignoring, you define your own mapping again that A to A, B to B. You are just putting the right column names against over there, each column that is being loaded in the CSV. Got it?
Okay. Thank you.
Right. So Lakshmi, is it working now?
It's not working. It's giving some error. I close it, but I can post that error.
Yeah, I'm getting some errors. We need to check the length, data type. Data type.
Yeah, you have to check the data type and the length of it. So suppose in the table, while getting that table, you have given the length as 20 and the data turned out to be of a little more size, so it will give you an error on that.
Okay, I can check that.
Just that would be the issue, apart from that you won't have any other issue.
Okay.
And right, like Divya, you know, like you asked about something, I'm really sorry, you know, I saw your message late. You asked about like, how do we do the data analysis, right? See, I'll tell you what we mean by data analysis. So on that, just a second. Just take one minute. This one says that I'm just sharing something. Right, so like this part you all would have done, right? So like the project that I have shared with you, so you all would have created the tables, right? So creation of the table, and you would have inserted the data using that CSV file. So, you know, we have the tables ready. After the tables get ready, right, you all would have loaded this data in this, right? So this is from the CSV file that you would have done. And then, you know, what we do is basically when it comes to doing the analysis, right? So in analysis, right, like what we do is we just see analysis is not a, analysis, you know, always looks a very fancy word to, especially to the people who are little new to the data science, okay? So analysis is nothing, it's more like trying to understand what kind of data do you have, right? What type of, you know, dates you have, what are the different status you have, right? First, you try to explore that. If you feel some data needs to be changed, you try to change that data, right? That what, if some data type you feel is not correct, you start, you select, you change those data types and make the data, clean the data and bring it into a correct shape. Then the analysis that you can do is, like, for example, I'm starting with the analysis over here. I am trying to see that who are the employees whose name starts with A and end with A, right? Find the common names from employee detail names and the customer names, right? Create a view where we are saying payment not done of those customers who have not paid their amount, right? We are trying to find those customers who have still not paid their amount so that, you know, the company can go and do their recovery of it, right? So we are selecting the observations of newly created view wherein, you know, we are saying, I mean, we're just saving the data in that, finding the frequency of each of the class of the payment mode, right? What payment mode people are choosing most number of the time, right? You can create a column, total payable charges, where you're finding the sum of shipping cost and the price, right? So this is how we start doing it. What is the highest total payable amount, right? Minimum total payable amount, extracting customer ID and customer name of the customers who were or will be the member of the branch for more than 10 years, right? Who got the product delivered on the next day and the product was sent? Which shipping content had the highest total amount? Right. So you have to just, by looking at the data, you just have to think of the scenarios, some insights which can be useful, you know, for your business, right? Something that could be helpful for you to, you know from your data now. That is something that we call it as data analysis now. And it could be anything, right? What we do is first we start analyzing by picking one variable at a time, right? Suppose you have a variable of amount, you have a variable of region status. Likewise, you will say, okay, how many regions do I have? What is the total balance, lowest balance, maximum balance, average balance? You calculate all those things. Then you start taking two or three variables together. What is the balance by region, balance by payment mode, right? Likewise, that is how basically the analysis happens. Okay, so in that entire part, you can create the views, you can use different functions, right? Like over here, finding the unique designation of the employees. So that is how this complete the analysis data analysis. Okay. So with this, let us move ahead and let's move to the Power BI now.
Is there any common structure, like how for a company, what all things we have to include in the query and all, right? Is there any common structure for that?
A common structure will follow the same process of ED, right? ED is something that is called as exploratory data analysis. And technically, this is more related to the Python. In SQL, we do not follow any such pattern over here, right? It's more like you just pick up the data and you start exploring it. The only thing that you can take care of is that you should start by something which is called as like, you know, univariate analysis, right? So you should start with univariate. Univariate means you take one variable at a time and analyze it, right? So you figure out which are the important variables for you. First task will be to identify the important variables on which the analysis could be done, right? Because if you have 100 columns in your data, right? If you have 100 columns in your data, so every column will not be useful for analysis. You find the, you know, important variables or important columns on which the analysis can be done, right? So find the important first columns. Then what you should do is you should start with the analysis by picking one column at a time.
I'm not seeing that screen where you're typing.
Oh, sorry. right? So how you should start doing it is basically you should first find the important columns in that different tables that you have, right? Then what you can do is you can understand the relationship that you have between the different tables. Now, based on that, you should start with one variable, one column at a time. You should pick one column at a time, for example, and then analyze it, right? What is the average, minimum, maximum, or the count basically, right? How many different categories you have or subcategories you have. Then what you do is you do bivariate. You pick two variables at a time or two columns at a time. And then you come to third, that is multivariate, right? Where what you do is you take multiple columns at a time. So this is the technique that we follow. But as such, there is no written guide of that because every database will be different. You will have different kind of tables, different kind of columns, and different column analysis, different type of analysis would be required. So that is how you cope with this.
Okay, okay. Let me try it. Yeah, let me try that. Thanks, Anu.
So Harsha, index that you have asked, so indexing is basically a technique which we use for the improvement of the performance of the, you know, improvement of the performance of the tables. Okay, so that is the technique which we call it as indexing. So right, like indexing, what we have is like we have an index in the book. Okay, like if you have to look out for a certain chapter, so what we do is we go to the index and we find the page number and directly jump onto that. Onto that chapter that we want to read. Now just imagine if you have to find your chapter but you don't have the index, right? So definitely it will take more time for you. Now same way, what we can do is if we want to improve the performance of the queries that we write, if we want to fetch the data from the tables at a faster pace, right? So what we can do in that case is we can actually make indexes on the table. Okay, so indexes is exactly the same thing like when you will write any query. So what will happen is the SQL is going to first go to the index table, find its row number, and it will give you the output of, and it will be able to find the output quickly from there. Like for example, if you have this table over here, that is this customer table. Okay. So suppose, you know, what happens is you write most of the queries that you write, you write it on the customer ID table, on the customer ID column. Suppose you write, you most of the time you write a query like select star from this customers where customer ID is equal to this, select star from customers where customer ID is equal to this. So now what happens is by default, if there is no indexing, so what SQL does is SQL goes in each row. It will check in each row wherever the customer ID matches, it stops and shows you the output, right? But when you make an index, in the index, what will happen is there are two types of indexes that we have. So indexes are of two types. One is called as clustered and one is called as non-clustered, right? Clustered index is, in this, what will happen is SQL will save the data in a sorted order, in the table only, right? In the table itself, the data will be sorted, the data will be stored in sorted order of customer ID. Okay, so now because the data is sorted, and if you say that I want to look out for that data where the order ID is 3000, so it knows that it has to go down and pick up the data of 3000. So it becomes easier for it. It doesn't have to go row by row. Okay. So when you create a primary key, right? When you create a primary key, that clustered index gets automatically created. So when you create a primary key, clustered index gets automatically created. And one table can have only one index, only one clustered index. And non-clustered indexes, in the non-clustered index, what happens is SQL creates another table in the memory. Okay, it will create another table in the memory. So So what will happen is you say that you want to create a clustered index on customer ID. So what SQL will do is it will create another table in the memory. And in that table, what it will do is it will store customer IDs and their row number. And customer IDs will be stored in a ascending or a descending order, whatever or whatever order you want. It will be sorted like this, right? 1, 2, 3. These are the customer IDs. These are the customer IDs that you have. 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, this is how you will have, and it will store the row number over here. That this I wrote this one number was coming in row number 8. This 2 was coming in row number 200, because over there your data was not properly sorted. So it will store all that information like this. So now if you write any query that select star from table where customer ID is equal to 5. So what SQL will do is first it will come to this table. It will say, okay, customer ID 5. It will check its row number. Then it will go into the main table and directly jump to that row number which it has found over here. So that way what happen is SQL saves the time of scanning each row every time. Okay.
Yes. Okay, Amit, but can you show that with the help of like a real database example? I mean, maybe
so
from the
point of view. You can't see anything in that case. So what will happen is you create this index like this. You say create index. Create index on the, you give the name to that index, ix underscore CID. This is the name of the index that you are creating. On, you give the table name, customer, and you define the column on which column you want to create your this index, right? So if I show you now, so what I've done is, this is how the index is created. If you say create index, this is the name of the index, the name of the table on which you created, and on which column do you want to create your index on, right? So this is how you make it. If you now run this query, so your index is created. So if you come to the DBO customer table, so you have a section of indexes, and you can see the index has been now created over here. So it's a non-clustered index. By default, it has created a non-clustered index for you. So what happens now is, that means now SQL has created another table in the memory. The name in that table, what has happened is like nothing would have changed. If you will see the data, you don't see any impact on the data. But in the memory, what has happened is it has created an index where it is storing that customer ID 230 is coming in row number 1. So all the customer IDs would be stored in a ascending order. They are sorted in the ascending order over there, right? So basically select star from this order by this CID. So technically what it has done is it has sorted those so it has stored all those customer IDs in this sorted order. Why is it not coming? So it's coming, yeah. So 1087, likewise, you can see it, right? So it has stored that row number of each of that customer ID in that in-memory table. Got it?
Yes, got it. But I have one question. Like every time we use this, we always have an index number over there. What is the purpose of creating this? We always we get this row number, right?
Row number what?
I mean, this, the leftmost column is always there. It's always 1, 2, 3. It's always in order. So it's
this number.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
This is just the numbering of the table, right? Like in Excel, you have the row number and column number. Na?
Yeah.
It is just that numbering, that this is just ABCD and this is the column number. So now if you see over here, now see, SQL also works the same way, like you will be looking out for a data. So the data that we have stored in that table. So what we have over here with us is, so this is not the row number of that, like in which row number the data is stored, because the data structure is this. Mm-hmm. Data structure of the table is this. Original way the data is stored in this structure. And mm-hmm. this 1, 2, 3 is just coming as a numbering. But it is not the number of that actual row, like what row is that. So So if you sort the data, this one will come for another row, right? If I sort this data, so if you see now one is coming for CID 230. If I sort it, so this one will come for that sorted order now.
Mm-hmm.
So that this 1, 2, 3 is not representing the row number of that.
Okay.
Got it?
Got it. And what so will now, be the question? I mean, yes. I just wanted to know like what the question would look like. Where do we have to use this?
See, indexing is used where you have big data sets. Big data sets you have. So now if I say that, you know, write a query where I want to find a data. I want to find the data of, so this was the table in which the data is stored. So I say, fetch me the information where the customer ID is 4094, right? So what will SQL do by default is, if I say this as where CID is equal to 4094, right? So suppose I write 4094. Now I want to find that data where the customer ID is this. Now what will happen in this case is SQL will not directly jump that row and it will fetch you the data. It will also have to look it. So it will go row by row. First row, second row, third row, fourth row, fifth row, and now it finds over here and it will be able to, then it will give you the data. But if suppose you have 10 lakh rows with you and the ID you were looking out for lies in the very last, don't you think you will be spending so much of time? It will be going through each row up to 10 lakh and it will take a lot of time for you to give that data in the output. So what we do is we create an index. So in that index, what will happen is the data will be stored in this sorted order in the in-memory table. It will first refer over there and find the row number and go to the main table and pick the data from there. So that is that. So the usage of the index is where you have huge amount of data. And you can actually create index on as many columns as you want. See, I can create a index on another column also. I can create an index on, I'm getting an index of customer name as well, right? So I create an index of customer name. So now what will happen is there is another in-memory table that has been created in which what we are doing is we are storing the data where we are storing the name. We are getting an index of the name of that table. Okay, so now if I run this, so again, another index would have been created. So if I refresh this over here, so see now I have two indexes. So that means two in-memory tables. So you also have to be very careful that you don't end up creating multiple indexes because that will also impact the performance. So because for every indexing, there is an in-memory table that is getting created and you keep on creating unnecessary indexes which you're not even using. So that will also impact the overall performance of your SQL server.
So it's basically for reducing the time, right?
Yes,
because if you run the query without creating index, the top query, I mean the one that is written so on the top,
time of resolution
anyway, it will work.
Ah.
So it's only for time. Okay.
And if you want to get a clustered index, you simply write this. So suppose, you know, I say this was the table. So now if you see, let me use MID now. MID. Because MID could be now this multiple over here as well. Right over here, create cluster. Right, so when you get a cluster, any cluster index, now you will notice something. When you make a cluster index, so what has happened is there is no new table that has been created. This existing table has been sorted. In this table only, now the data is stored in a sorted sequence of MID. Right now, this is a permanent change that you can see over here. So now because the data is sorted, so now again it is easier for SQL to go to that particular row and pull that data. right? So if you say you want to see the data where MID is 115, so it is a one way round, right? It will simply go that because the data is sorted, it knows that it has to go in a little later in the downside row and it can pick that up from there. So in the cluster indexing, the data gets stored in a sorted way, and in a non-cluster index, it creates an in-memory table. Okay? Please remember this thing. Cluster index, you can have only one, right? Because you can only sort the data by one column. You cannot sort the data by multiple columns by getting multiple indexes. So that is why you can only have one cluster index.
Okay, like if you don't want to extract the whole data, suppose there is one more column, say of payment or something like that. And if you want to have a customer type wholesale and who made a payment with card, so is index used over there, something like that? I mean, are we matching the row and the column, something that we used to do in Excel?
No, you make an index on column only, one column. So which column on the column, if you think that a customer name column you use a lot for writing your query, so you will create an index on customer name.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah. Okay, so it's basically only for time.
Yeah. I didn't get your point, last one.
No, it's like in Excel, we used to match the row and the column accordingly. The index works, like we match the column and the row.
So, something like that. Something.
But we are not doing here. I mean, we don't need index. Why are we using it? We can.
Why do we not index?
I mean, if you want to search a particular customer ID, details of a particular customer ID, it's only for time saving we are using. Apart from that, there is no other purpose of using index.
It's a time saving, yes. So that it knows that way, which row to pick and now, right? If I give you a book of 10,000 pages and I don't give you any index to you and I say, okay, please open this chapter number 5, definitely you will take a lot of time. You will keep on going through all the pages and then you will say, okay, here comes the chapter number 5. But if you will have an index, you will go over there and you will say, okay, chapter 5 starts from page number 3000. So you will simply jump to the page number 3000 and you will be able to open that chapter. So that is the whole purpose that index we create.
Okay. Yes. Thank you.
Okay. So let's open this Power BI file that we are using. Okay. So yesterday, you know, this is what we had worked upon, right? This was the report that we did. So we were talking about formatting of the charts, right? Talking about the maps. We talked on the drill up feature functionality, right? I think we talked on those parts. And we also talked about how we can make the user-defined hierarchies in the Power BI. So those are the things that we had covered. Any question you would like to ask before I move ahead? Did we talk about edit interactions yesterday? Edit interactions we didn't talk, right?
No.
So now let's start from here, right? So what we did was, so we had just talked about, I get a little confused. So because, from the last 2 days, I have been training almost like 4 batches of Power BI in a day. It's like first time it has happened that, like right after your batch, there's a Infosys to whom I am teaching Power BI. then there is another company conference to them also I'm teaching Power BI. So it just gets so much confusing for me that what topic did I teach to which batch the last day. So that's so. Because we have to talk about filters also, we have to talk about. See, now what happens is this report that we have created, right? So we were trying to understand some of the charts in this. So what happens in Power BI is Power BI also provides you a lot of good functionalities in terms of filtering your data. Okay, now when it comes to filtering your data, so let's try to understand it. What do I mean? See, you have one visual over here that is called as slicer. Okay, so if you pick up the slicer now over here, right? In the slicer, what you can do is you can keep some fields based on which you can filter the data. Right, like this is a slicer visual. Now in the slicer, what I do is if I pick the field of region and I put it over here. So what will now happen is if you click on central, the entire report will filter out for central. If you select east, the entire report gets filtered for east. Right. So whatever region you select, the data gets filtered based on that. Okay. So this is a quick slicer that you can use to bring that interactiveness to that report that you are creating. So please try this. So now you know this slicer that you have, by default it looks like single select. If you want to make multiple regions, you will just have to press control key. So if you press control key and select another region, so you will be able to do that, right? So if you press control key, you are able to select two regions also, right? And on the top of this filter, you know, over here you will notice there is a small arrow that is coming. One is clear filter, right? Like if you have selected something, you want to clear the selection, you can click on this. And if you click on this little arrow over here, right, if you click on this arrow, you can change its look and feel. Like you want, you can make it a drop down. So in the drop down, the filter will come like this. You select, make your selection and you close it, right? So you can have it this way or the other way. Now over here, if you're in this, if you're selected this filter, if you'll come to the formatting pane, right? If you come to the format pane, over here you have some options to modify this, right? If you click on the selection controls, you can turn on. So if you make it single select on, so in that case, the chart will be only single select. You won't be able to make multiple selections. Okay. Every time you will only be able to make one selection only. But if you turn it off, it becomes a multi-select. Now multi-select by default over here, you will find it is, you will see there is an option that is checked, that is multi-select with control. That means if you have to make a multiple selection, you will have to press control key. If you turn it off, right, if you turn this off, so you will be able to make the multiple selections just by clicking on it. You will not have to press control key. Okay, you will be able to make that multiple selection just by pressing control. Without pressing control. So you have to just turn that off. You want to show a select all option, you can come down and you can say select all. So in the filter, you will get dropped off a select all option also. You can add as many slices as you want. So for example, you now pick here, pick the region. You want another slicer as well. So you can also copy a chart, right? If you say copy and paste, so a duplicate of that chart is created. This actually helps you in just, saving the time of all that formatting that you need to do. So what you do now is you can bring ship mode over here. If you bring the ship mode inside this, same day, first class, whatever you want to do, you can filter the data based on that. So now you can have two slices. So if you want to see the data of West region, in the West region, you want to see the data of a particular shipping mode, you can select that. And then, you know, if you want to just put up a title, you can just click on insert, just a quick thing. You can click on text box and you can write something you want. Suppose this is sample superstore report. You can put that. Make it central line, bold, increase the text size. So you can create a title like this. So you can put up a title and you can just turn the background off like this. Please do it, right? So you all just do it. I'll just be back in a minute. Okay, so shall I, any questions, anyone? I hope you are able to do it. Okay. See, now the next thing that we're going to talk about over here is, that is called as interaction. See, now I'm talking about the different type of filters that you have. So one is slicer visual that I just showed you, right? How you can give a feature of a person can select something. So let me just make sure nothing is selected. Let's say select all. Now right now I have all the data. See what happened is by default also in Power BI you have a feature of interaction. Interaction means, see, like when you click on anywhere on the chart, right? Other charts, they get affected by that, right? They get either filtered or highlighted, right? The other charts get affected by that over here. So if I'll show you now, so see, if you select furniture, all the charts are getting changed. The values are getting changed. So this is called as interactions among the chart. Now, what is that? So basically, interactions are of three types. So each and every chart will interact with other chart. So there are three types. One is filter, another is highlight, and one is none. Okay, so how these basically work is, so when you filter means, I mean, the data will be filtered. So if you select something on chart one, on the other charts, the data will be filtered, right? And then you have highlight. Highlight means that when you select something on chart one, on the other charts, the things will be highlighted, right? So what's the difference between filter and highlight? So if you see now, see, when I'm clicking over here, right, on this chart, when I'm clicking on sales by category, when I'm clicking on furniture, this chart is getting highlighted, right? Basically, when I'm selecting furniture, it is only showing me the data of furniture. Rest are grayed out. But on the line chart, it is getting filtered, right? Filtered means that the data of furniture category is only visible on this line chart. That in 2014, what was the sales in furniture? 15. What was the sales? 16 and 17. This is called as filtering, right? Filtering means only that selected data will be visible. Highlight means all the data will be there, just that selected data will get a little highlighted, right? It will come into the focus over there. So that is what the default, by default, what happens is Power BI does that interactions automatically. Now what you do is, if you just, you want to change that interaction, right? If suppose I want that if I click anywhere on this furniture chart, nothing should happen on any other chart, or the filtration should happen on this chart. So what we do is we go on the format. You just see it, and then you can just please do it at your end. So you click on edit interactions, right? You select that chart, you go on the format and you say edit interactions. When you click on edit interactions, you will notice you will get these options at the top of the chart. These options will come up. Now these are the same options that I was telling you. This is option of filter. This is none. That means if you change it to none, that would mean that if you select anything on this chart, nothing is going to happen on this. There will be no interaction between them. If you come on this chart, there are three options: filter, highlight, and none. So right now, the option selected by default is coming as highlight. That means when you select something on this, this chart is getting highlighted. If you make it as filter, then this should get filtered, and this will also get filtered. And other chart, suppose I keep it unchanged the way they are, I keep it them the way that way only, and then I click on edit interactions. Now those options are gone. See, now if you will see, if I click on furniture, see, this is getting filtered now. This is getting unimpacted. This has not changed now, but this has got filtered now. It is not getting highlighted this time. It is now just showing me the categories of furniture now, subcategories of furniture now, because it has filtered out. So now if I click on office supplies, it will show me only the subcategory of office supplies. So that is how these interactions can be changed, and you will actually have to change the interaction of every single chart with other charts. So if you want to change the interaction of this chart, so you click on this format, edit interactions, and now you can change the interaction of this chart with every other chart. Suppose you want that if you click anywhere on this chart, nothing should happen over here, nothing should happen over here, nothing should happen over here. So you can do it, right? And you click on this. Now if you will click anywhere on this chart, nothing is going to change. Okay. So now all of you please try this out. Okay. Yep. I hope you are able to understand it, these interactions. Okay. Now, you know, there are some more, a couple of quick visuals that I will be showing you. So right now you have a visual of card, right? If you want to show a quick number, right? So card is a visual with the help of which you can only show one single value, right? Suppose you want to showcase what was the total sales. You pick up the sales and put it over here. So it tells you that this was the total sales that was generated. Okay, so you can see it from here, the sales number. Okay. Just have to put a card. So you want to show a quick summary as in, so you can use a card over here. Okay. I can also do formatting again. So formatting is changing the colors and all. So you want to change the background color, how to turn it off. So this is the total sales. Below you have a category label, right? Category label, just you want to make it little big. So you can do that. And this is total sales. Same way, you can just make a copy of this. And you put a profit inside it. So you can show the total profit over here. So just making, if you have to show a quick number at the top, you can just use this. You want to put up a logo on this report, right? So you can just put up a logo. You click on insert and you click on image, right? So you want to put any logo over here, so you can do that. Just pick up that logo. You can download any image, and then what you can do is you can just put it at the top wherever you want. So this way, you know what happens is the report that you are creating, it gets a more kind of an appeal, right? That you know, in this logo you have an option of scaling. So in the scaling you can make it fill, so this comes the entire, takes the entire space. So it gives you that, okay, this is your brand that you are representing on the report that you have made. So I think, Lalit, this is where, you know, I think I'll take a pause for today, right? You know, because we have actually, I want to show you 2-3 functionalities, but they're a little time consuming. So what we will do is, so that we'll start from here tomorrow. And in the meantime, you know, what I'll be doing is I'll share a small assignment again on the Power BI right now, which you all can work on it. And maybe we can discuss on that tomorrow on that, right? So try to make it a professional report. So I'll just share that Power BI report on the classroom. And we'll start working on that. Okay. So tomorrow, you know, probably basically we will be starting with the data transformation, so which is the all the ETL and the data transformation capabilities that Power BI has. So we will be talking on that. So from there we will start.
You will be sharing the assignment now in the classroom.
On the classroom, so I'll put it over there.
Okay, then thank you for the session, Amit.
Sure.
Bye, all.
Thank you for the session, Amit. Bye, all.
Thank you. Bye.